Hiya, we're Alisha's Attic.
Can you tell me what you think of Alisha's Attic?
I think they're wonderful.
The first single is called I Am I Feel.
Right. Fantastic.
Our band's fabulous.
Oh, the crowd's coming.
Any free tickets?
We're working on it.
They're lovely girls, they're wonderful, and I hope they go straight to the top of the charts.
Fantastic, love them.
I think that the album will be released in September, sometime. After the single's been finished, and then we're going to do another single.
Best in the world, Alisha.
Looking forward to it.
We went to Newcastle, Manchester, Birmingham, Edinburgh, and this is the last show tonight in London, so it's all been a good one.
I put my heels together three times, it sparked a little but nothing happened.
The experience of recording the album was quite, was an experience.
Wacky.
Psychedelic. Weird.
I know, I feel, sometimes things that you forget.
We recorded it at the church with Dave Stewart in Crouch End, and it was absolutely fabulous.
Kind of devilish and angel-like character, and she's got a halo and a beautiful white dress, but she's got horns and a fork and smudge lipstick and red wine everywhere.
It's basically about being good and bad all in one person. Stuff is like secondary to the music, which we're really focused about, and we're really confident with that. So the rest of it is such fun because we can just lay back
have
and
fun.
Can just have a laugh.
And we do.
We do.
And we do.
It's great.
So who are your fans for?
I'm a first fan. Ooh, many people, mostly males.
Jimi Hendrix
is top.
Yeah, me too.
Jimmy. The Doors. I love The Doors. I like all kind of 70s sort of rock and punk.
They're no longer punk. Here anymore.
Through the real punk stages. There's so many influences in our music.
Okay.
We really respect each other's strengths and weaknesses, and we can make them work for, you know,
because we're both so other. Separate people, aren't we? Both totally different people.
Yeah, I normally write most of the lyrics, and,
but you write quite some of the lyrics.
Yeah, because it's a real big kind
and of I play guitar too,
yeah.
And piano, and triangle,
and accordion. Alisha's Attic, we record all our songs, we've got a little attic in our
attic
in our house. We needed it to be called something attic because we thought it would be called and write all our songs in the attic, so it made sense. So we thought of every other woman's name and we couldn't think of anything that really was really good, and then we wrote the song Alisha Rules the World and we came up with this big thing, and so it kind of flowed quite nicely.
Yeah.
Alisha's Attic.
Brilliant, wicked, love the girls, love the styling, love the music, love it.
Nice video, very nice video.
And I am, I feel, I sometimes think that you forget, but I am, I feel, I got to get away from here. I am, I feel, and this girl's a person, you know. I am, I feel.
Shelley is, she's completely moody. She's completely moody.
Karen is bossy.
She's really bad in the morning, like totally bad.
I can't be horrible, she's sweet, she's fine.
You're just a bit sort of self-centred sometimes.
Self-centred?
Well, you are sometimes a little bit.
How?
Oh, shush.
That's so strange. That's you.
We have got to start fighting. Thank you.
devil's on our tongue.
Push It All Aside is really like the song that most describes me and Shelley. I mean, if you want to know what we're about, then just listen to the song, really, because it is so about, you know, our sort of personalities and the video as well. I mean, we've made a perfect video that fits our personalities down to a T.
So let's push it all aside, let's swallow our pride and realize that nothing could be sweeter than loving each other if we look at who is wrong and who's right. Yeah, let's push it all aside, let's swallow our pride and realize that nothing could be sweeter than loving each other if we look at who is wrong.
Push It All Aside was like the one where we didn't know what was going to happen. We had no plan.
We had no script.
We had, you know, it was really quirky. It was just like, okay, you're going to dress identically. You're going to sit in two chairs. You're going to just be yourself. And we made up those little dance routines. You know, people are now going, oh, love the choreography. And we're like, but there's no choreography. You know, it's just, it just happened.
Let's push it all aside, take a swallow of pride and realize that nothing could be sweeter than loving each other if we.
We both take adopted roles. Like, my role is much more passive in the studio than Karen's, and yet when it comes to actually singing and performing, I'm much more dominant than Karen. But in the writing side of it, Karen's a lot more bossy, and we're like that in real life too. I normally come up with the lyrics, and
that's when we actually start arguing. At that point,
yeah, it's like we can sit, you know, like sometimes I'll sit there and I'll write, you know, like what I think is a brilliant song, the whole thing. Then I'll go to Shell and I'll go, right, this is the song, this is how it's going to be, you know, because I am a control freak. And Shell goes, oh no, I don't like that, you can't repeat that twice, that's awful, you've got to do it like this, you put this word in, I don't like that. And that's where we're like,
I remember sort of sitting with Karen about I Am, I Feel in my front room in Debenham. She's like, what do you think? It goes, and I am, I feel, and I'm like, I really like that, but that should be the chorus. She's like, oh, don't be ridiculous. She stormed out, don't be so bloody
ridiculous.
Because
I'd only written a verse and a bridge, and I was like, I really like this verse and bridge, and it goes, and this is the bridge, and then we're going to go into a huge big chorus, Shell, and she was like, but that should, you should repeat that again for the chorus. And I'm like, no way, no way.
And then she come back about an hour later, because she lived two doors away from me, knocking on the door, okay then.
Can't think of anything better, how about this? We actually had never had any intention of making a third record, really. You know, we were ready to sit and write pop songs for pop bands and do that whole thing of not particularly making it real for us anymore, because we didn't think the public really wanted to hear anything real, because the charts were so uninspiring, you know. So we just started sitting in our attic and writing tunes, and they just came out of nowhere, but they came from somewhere different, I think. It just came from a real sort of, you know, we were totally inspired by old 60s music and, you know, like Dusty Springfield, you know, listening to Dusty in Memphis or whatever. It was just totally like, God, she's got it so right, you know. So we switched off everything that was anything to do with now. And we just sat there and we sort of like had a good time and found that we could actually do it and have a good time together, and, you know.
And the joy came back to writing and to being in the studio together, whereas before we weren't having any joy at all. The joy actually came back to it, and we were like, oh, we've written such a great song, it's a classic. Everything to do with when you're trying to write and create something, the surroundings have to be different every time, otherwise it gets staid and bored. And
we got off the plane, we drove 3 hours north up on this little like windy road in the middle of nowhere, and we ended up in the middle of nowhere in this little log cabin, literally. And you know, we met this guy that built the trail, and we produced the album, and it just went from there. You know, we were totally closed off, and it was like, it's a great feeling of not being, you know, near anything, and no pressure, nobody turning around and saying, you should do it like this, or you should look like this, or you should, you know, we were like, stayed back, we're going off.
Yeah.
All you had to do was concentrate on the music, and that's why everybody who lives up there is like painters and all sort of mad creative people, because there's nothing else to do. So it's really good. It's, you just channel everything into that project, and we just for 2 months just completely got into it, didn't we? It was brilliant.
Started out so good, there was nothing.
The house that we Vanderbilt is the title track of the album, and it's a really sweet song about, you know, your home life falling apart and everything you built up with your partner has suddenly gone to nothing. And it's really sad and melancholy, but it's so organic and beautiful at the same time. It makes me cry.
Now I feel all lost, I got no home. I feel all alone in the house that we built. No bricks, it's got no stones. You took all the love out of the house that we built. No guts, it's got no bones. I feel so alone in the house that we built.
The album title came from the song House That We Built, which was we actually wrote when we were in America, which was one of the last ones we wrote, wasn't it? And then it just sort of all fell into place, you know. I'm consciously thinking about the house that we built when we were sort of writing it. I thought, well, that'd be a great album title, and it all tie in, you know, sort of subconsciously thinking that. But that's where it came from, just from the song, really. We've had to completely, like, lay the foundations again and, you know, do the whole thing from start. You know, it's not been sort of like just, oh yeah, let's, you know, polish it up a bit. I mean, we've literally bashed it all down and stuck it all back up again.
Fucking great.
A lot of hard work.
Sex on Everyone's Tongue was one of the... It was actually written while we were away on a writing trip. We went to the country and we saw trees and nice things, and Sex on Everyone's Tongue was one of those. It just came out really quickly. It's like a little ditty. It means, you know, it's not a proper song really. There's no form to it, there's no chorus, but it works perfectly.
Everybody wants to get a quick hit, a quick fix, and that's just what's going on.
Because a lot of the songs were all about love and stuff, we just wanted to write something quite tongue-in-cheek about, you know, the sort of casualness of just writing that kind of song and all what, you know, how funny it is about, you know, people just, you know, having one-night stands with someone and all that kind of stuff, you know, from that angle. And then just wanted to come up with a title first, and we did, and it was quite easy to write. It came really, really quickly. Thing about when we recorded the record was that we were part of a team, you know. Actually making the record was very much, you know, a gang of people sitting around and recreating what we'd done in the attic or in the warehouse, you know. So it was a great feeling of being part of a team, and live work is definitely another thing where you know, we're not completely in control, you know. We let the musicians have a you know, a big part of it, because it is, you know. It shouldn't be about me and Shelley stuck at the front and our band at the back all in black t-shirts, you know, because that's naff, you know. We really want to be part of something that, so our vibe when we play to people is like about us, you know, all of us on stage and having a good time.
When you're touring and you're with your members of your band and you're this lovely little team, I just think there's nothing more fulfilling than actually seeing people singing your songs as well. Because you don't see that when you're in the studio. You're just you, and you're just, you know, in that little tight thing. But when you're out there and actually seeing who buys your records, I mean, it's a strange array of people. It's actually good to see who's, you know, who's getting you and who likes you. The people that actually are our sort of loyal fans are so lovely. We always say that, don't we? We've been really lucky, like, we've,
yeah. Yeah. I think we might actually change our audience quite a bit with this record, though. I mean, I think people that listen to the first album and the second album may... I don't know if they'll be put off, but they'll definitely be like, wow, that's really different, because it is really quite a sort of totally different step for us to take, you know. But that's good. I mean, if we'd have just made an album that was just the same old, everyone would be bored, and we'd be bored more importantly. So, I mean, it is quite a sort of jump, you know, and people would be like, ooh.
The whole album is so organic, and so it's all just, you know, walking around the studio and finding something to make a noise with. It's all... the way it should be. It's the way music should sound. There's no labour to it. It was just so easy to mic everything up and, you know, make noise and make it sound incredible, which is this stuff that's polished and all shiny today. Just you lose the vibe and you lose the rawness and the real, you know, passion behind it. And this album's got all of that, and we're so proud of it.
I've had with swimming, my feet get too wet. The water's too cold. I am out of my depth.
Pilot just reminds me of just going off like that a bit. You know, it was one of it was the first song actually that we wrote on the album, and
really simple chords, really simple, and wanted to be a bit clever with the lyrics, you know, wanted to do something a bit different, and I just think it works, you know, it sounds so dramatic. It's inspired by Somewhere Over the Rainbow, and the words all say the same thing. You're trying to find ways to get out, and there's all these things you're trying to, you know, you've tried walking, you've tried taking locomotives, and you've tried steam engines, and you're still there. And it's, I love it, the strings are so dramatic as well. When I listen to it, it almost feels like it should be a James Bond theme tune.
We actually know we've made a brilliant record because our friends are telling us we've made a brilliant record. The people that, you know, that we really admire and respect are telling us we've made a great record, and we know we've written a brilliant record, you know, so it feels so comforting. It's like that, you know, like when we say we want to be in a fishbowl, it's like we're in this brilliant little thing and, you know, we've done it all ourselves sort of thing.
Tender Got My Heart is the probably, well, I can listen to it over and over and over again. It started off really small and turned into the grand string production, but it's perfect.
Love was a game anyone to bust. Yeah, love was a painkiller that never lasts. And I hate to say that I won't care for it no more. Yeah, it was real to start, but I pretend I got my heart.
I would say it's probably one of my favourites because it's just got that European feel to it, and when we did first record it, it freaked me out a bit that it was very sort of, you know, we made it like with the zither and everything, it was all a bit sort of, it got a bit too Fiddler on the Roof for me, and I freaked out for a short while there, but now I'm just so into it, and I love the fact that it's all a bit gypsy, and it's really emotional, you know, I love the emotion in it, it's amazing.
And now all I is what you forgot, and it's all because of you, baby. And all that my heart needs now is a rest and place in the day. Oh,
we've always been totally inspired by like old Fellini films, and when we met Sophie Muller, the girl that directed it, you know, she totally had the same influences as us, didn't she? She was just really sort of on the same wavelength, and we just always wanted to do something that was like old. We didn't want to do anything in vogue, we didn't want to do anything trendy, anything, you know, that puts us in the mould with everyone else. We wanted to do a video that looked classic and different, and, you know, something that actually pushed people's buttons a bit to show that it's not normal, you know, it's not what everyone else is doing.
When we filmed Pretend I Got My Heart, we went to Spain to do it, and to find a video that matched the sort of grandness of the song Pretend I Got My Heart was really difficult. Yeah. So the only way we could have done that was to make a mini movie, and all the time we're like, it's okay, it's only a pop video, and we're like, nope, we are making a mini movie,
and we're waiting for our Oscars right now as we speak.
For 13 years, and so we've been doing it so long we actually completely know our roles, and it almost works like two bloody actresses. With, you know, it really does, you know when to hold your hands up and go, you know what, I can't do that, you do that, even though it kills you to do it.
Betty and Joan, that's what.
Yeah.
Betty and Joan. I don't know which one I am though, am I Betty or Joan?
Well, you're Betty.
I think I'm Betty
because you've got blonde hair.
Oh,
that's, oh, get the woof, there you go, blonde.
But Betty was the better actress.
Well, that's debatable.